Hi, I'm Elton John, and tonight's program is about Michael Chugg, who is one of the greatest concert promoters in the whole wide world, and certainly the greatest Australian promoter out there. He's been doing it for a long time, like myself. We've known each other for an awful long time, and we've all had our ups and downs. We've both had an incredible life, crazy, and now a little slower paced. But he is one of the great characters of the music industry, and tonight is his Australian story.
Joe's just given me this wonderful pen for my 60th birthday. It's from Tiffany & Co. Guess what it's got? The inscription, Wanker. Thanks, Joe. I remember that. I've always wanted a Tiffany pen with Wanker inscribed on it. Take the entire hierarchy of the stage to fix a generator that's run out of fuel. Get.
Unfortunately, I had a great grandfather, and the first thing he did was taught me to swear. And it's always been a major part of my delivery of things.
London were watching the pictures.
Today's smoking venue, mate.
There might have been one or two instances over the 40 years where I was probably out of order, but in the main, it's usually been because it needed to be done.
More bullshit. More bullshit.
Sorry about that. I can't believe it.
And I've got to tell you, the use of in the right context changes a lot of things.
You're useless. A lot of...
It's like a wave aid. It's a perfect example. 20 or 30 larrikins were trying to bring alcohol onto the ground. It was starting to get really tense.
But there's a few yobos in the green area who are causing a problem and ruining the show for everybody. You Now, you idiots in the green that are wanting to punch people because you can't bring beer onto the ground, either do the right thing or off.
Yes, he swears like there's no tomorrow. Yes, he smokes. But he's good enough to know he does it. He was sometimes more memorable than the act that went on after him. But it's all a part of how Michael sets himself apart, frankly, from his competitors. He's out there. And it helps.
Hopefully we won't the ground, eh?
Nah, it'll be sweet.
So I can rely on you meatheads to keep it all cool.
We'll try not to litter today.
You know, it's a bit unfortunate that he hasn't caught up to the modern age a little bit. As time went on, you know, the standards and discrimination and sexual talk, etc., you know, was something that we took pretty seriously. Well, Michael didn't. You know, I mean, we lost the Pearl Jam tour because of one of those discussions on stage.
We're just a bit worried about all these anti-nuclear T-shirts that are actually infiltrating the stage.
How's it going, Sydney?
Well, it's all about live Earth, so we're a bit worried about the cross messages, and we're just about to have a quiet talk to a couple of artists about that.
You been having a good day?
So, how do you tell an artist what to wear?
Listen, you wanker, take that T-shirt off now. Mr. Kelly, sir.
Have a good one, brother.
Basically, dealing with artists, if you're treating them right and they like you, it's never as hard as it's made out to be.
See, he's my stylist.
The boys, I'm looking forward to the big stadium debut in Sydney.
And that's what it's all about. Look after the act and they'll do the right thing 99% of the time. They like me, I'm a character, you know.
How are you?
Very good, mate.
Yes,
not bad.
Egos, you know. I used to have a monstrous ego, so they tell me.
Some silly demands, which everybody's...
Part of the course, really.
Well, it is, isn't it?
Yeah, you get that many acts and egos in one place.
It's going good.
It's good, mate.
If you look after them, I've never really found any of them to be out of control. Billy Idol was pretty interesting. We had an after-show party in a club in Sydney. He locked himself in the one room, dressing room there with 9 hookers and wouldn't come out.
How are you?
Well done.
Thank you.
That was fantastic.
Good on you for putting your dinners together today.
Michael has better relationships with performing artists than anyone else I've had much to do with in my life. It's not the image that he conveys when he's on stage telling the guy in the black T-shirt to back off.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I was so nervous.
I know. Yeah. I could see you.
He's a man of significant compassion, and he's very vulnerable. So that's a very important quality for performance artists who have their own insecurities.
I've been waxing lyrical about you. I'm really well.
I've known Elton since the early 70s. A couple of tours ago, I got an email after the tour from his manager saying, Elton thinks you don't like him anymore. He said, well, you didn't give him a present at the end of the tour.
I actually think it's the original Rocket Man.
Yeah, it looks a bit like that.
It does.
Beautiful. But...
And, of course, the present was together. We just were so busy, we didn't give it to him. This time, we made sure he got a beautiful painting.
I just wanted to present this to you.
Thank you so much
for giving
such a wonderful... Look at her face as well.
Yeah, she's 70 years old, actually. And,
Bless her heart. Well, it's funny because Michael is one of these people that stays out the way. I'm not bombarded by his office to do this and do that. He leaves me alone, but if he needs something to be done, I'll do it. Because, you know, I trust him and I trust his judgment. He's a dream kind of promoter. He's the best. And that's why we come down here, because of Chuggy. And, you know, he loves music. He's been around for so long. He's been around practically as long as I have.
We know we belong to the land.
I was born in Launceston in 1947. I was basically brought up listening to the latest albums of Fats Waller and Woody Herman and Louis Armstrong, and also the cast albums of My Fair Lady, Flower Drum Song, Oklahoma, Oklahoma.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
When I was older, when Elvis Presley came along, I truly wanted to be Elvis. I had the broomstick guitar and used to do all that in the lounge room at home when no one was there.
Well, they said you was hard last.
And I was a cyclist and I won a few races and everything. And one night at the cycling, the local commentator track announcer didn't turn up, so I volunteered to call the bikes. I started broadcasting.
You ain't nothing but a
hound dog. And I then ended up calling horse racing and trotting and greyhounds and football.
Gets to Melbourne, puts a lot of money on a dog that's in the race. The race heads off, Michael's calling the race for all of Tasmania. The dog comes around the corner into the straight leading by 5 laps and the famous words are, I'll be f***ed, it's fallen over. It was the end of his life as a radio announcer in Tasmania.
So I got into rock and roll and started, you know, running dances all over Tasmania, and that's where it began. I was just a working class kid. I went off to Melbourne with a Tasmanian band, and there was this young guy there with red hair and a big nose who was booking all these new bands. His name was Michael Gudinski, and we became friends. Someday.
Chuggy came in and, you know, he did everything from put up posters, you know, hand out handbills, do everything that we all did when we started. And even though Chuggy was a bit older than me, he had a really great passion for the business and really became part of our team, and it really grew from there. There was a whole blast of new music at the time.
In 79, 80, we started Frontier Touring. We had this amazing run through the late 80s and early 90s where we were the biggest touring company in this part of the world. And it was a pretty volatile relationship. We became world famous for some of the blues we used to have backstage.
A lot of people, you know, used to say that, you know, I was the brains and Chugg was the brawn, but I think that's a bit unfair. I mean, Chugg was a solid guy that, you know, really worked for the acts, looked after the crew. I said,
He was trying to seduce me away from another well-known manager of the time. And so he got me down to this place in Barnes Point. And then this hospital kept phoning. And it took a while for it to dawn on me that his firstborn, which would be Nick, was being born. And so on. Chuggy's sort of trying to lure me away from this other manager. Well, it's a perfect example, really, of Chuggy's overwhelming passion. I've never known such a passionate person for the music industry itself.
Most people I know think that I'm crazy. And...
One year, my father was named Father of the Year for all of his charitable deeds. Behind the scenes, Dad and his wife at the time, Lisa, weren't getting along too well. There were a lot of times where he wasn't there. He obviously had to go overseas quite a fair bit, or even just interstate. He'd be touring a lot with bands. It was a bit difficult when I was younger.
It's certainly been tough on family, relationships, not being there when you really, really need it. And, you know, I've had two marriages fall apart. And, I have fairly good relationships with my ex-wives. The biggest buzz in this for me is making small bands into big bands and being there with them in the hard times and the good times, and it really is the ultimate for me. And I just felt in the late 90s that I wasn't doing what I needed to do. Our financial people just couldn't understand why we did these little bands and lost 40 or 50 grand. Michael had lost a bit of interest, so I decided it was time to have a crack at it and start my own thing, my own company, and my own touring, and do what I wanted to do, and that's what I did.
It's probably the hardest thing I've ever done in my life, leaving Michael, because Michael is one of the great people in the Australian music business. But there were other elements that were just, I just didn't want to be part of.
You know, it's like a divorce. You know, the breakup wasn't ugly, but it was a bit frustrating, I think. And, you know, if he walked in the door tomorrow, you know, we'd have a hug. And I think there's always going to be respect there.
I made the jump and I don't regret it, but it wasn't easy. And I mean, you know, as well as having other people in the Australian industry wanting to wipe me out, I now had my best friend trying to wipe me out. So it was, you know, it was a challenge, and it was very hard to do.
They both have ragingly large egos. They're highly competitive. They love each other in their own very, very weird way. And at the same time, they're at war with each other. It's like most marriages. So there was, in the end, never going to be room enough for both of them on the same stage.
Good morning, Steve. You all right, son? No dramas?
Nah, it's all good.
The first couple of years was a big learning curve. I made some horrendous mistakes, and it could have gone either way there for a while.
Morning. Hey, Matt.
And I let him get off to a pretty good start.
Oh, here we are.
Because I had a lot of other things going on and I perhaps was a little bit relaxed about it. He basically convinced a lot of people that I was like, had my feet up in the air and ready to retire from touring. And that was pretty smart, Chuggy, I must admit.
We need to punch some figures up and see what it really looks like.
I've got the
I mean, if we get all that money we're talking about off sponsors and government, well, he might change his mind.
All right, well, there's a budget for that.
Promoting rock and roll is like being a professional horse punter or a professional poker player. Total gamble, it's a total punt. And when you see an act, you think this could be great and it turns out to go the wrong way, so you lose a lot of money.
Thanks, brother.
That's the offering budget.
Mm. Oh, there was a hell of a lot of pressure on me. It was about, I don't know, 2 years later, I was in Los Angeles I woke up one morning with this amazing pain. And I basically had a blocked artery and
had a heart attack and was rushed to hospital and operated on immediately and a stent put in and thrown out of hospital 2 days later.
Oh, it was pretty serious. There was one day where it was very bad. From what I've heard, the doctors said he was really lucky not to die. It was a weird one, the heart attack. It was probably the one time he didn't really say a lot. I had to actually force a lot of the heart attack information out of his secretary at the time. I don't know if he was embarrassed or ashamed. He to this day, he's never really spoken a lot about the heart attack.
Well, I've kept it a bit to myself ever since, really. This is the first time anybody's ever got me to really talk about it. And there was certainly no knowledge or press on it. I've been okay since, but whenever I do something a bit off the wall, you know, all the rumours go around that I'm retiring, or I get a really good office situation, all of a sudden there's rumours going around that my business has been taken over and I'm just a figurehead and everything. So at the time, huge publicity about the heart attack would have probably been the worst thing that could have happened because everybody would have used it against me. It was tight around the end of 2002. I toured the Chili Peppers, who I had a huge, long relationship with, and Santana. And both tours were disasters. And it's like, where did that come from? That could have been the end right there. I was down, could have been $4 million that we were in the hole for at that stage. But fortunately, I had a relationship with an English agent and he told me about this artist that he thought was going to be the biggest act in the world. And in 2003, the act exploded. Robbie Williams was the little man's name. And that was the beginning of it all really falling into place. I don't want to rock,
DJ. It's amazing. A bloke who loves grunt rock and roll got saved by a pop star. In Robbie Williams's case, the business was fivefold what they thought it was going to be when they initially did the first deal. And that's what made Chuggy's future secure. They were able to sell out stadiums, literally, cricket grounds, football fields. That's big business in anyone's language, and it doesn't happen in this country very often.
Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Michael Chugg. Yeah!
It feels fantastic, and it also has enabled me to do a lot more for the industry, whether it be helping kids, charities. It's just something I love doing, and it's all about karma. It's all about giving back.
10! I got 10,000 down the front. 11! 11! Yeah, come on!
The Wave Aid concert we did for the tsunami benefit, 9 months later, after the DVD had come out, that we were able to go to Sri Lanka and Thailand and, you know, do things like start proper English curriculum for primary school kids in those countries. It's funny how things are. You know, I've never really been deeply religious or anything, but about 4 years ago I was on my way home from a music conference in London and I decided to have a week in Phuket. And I love Thailand, and I got off the plane and I just felt something. I just felt something. Something was happening in Phuket, and I just felt this thing, and and there was this incredible thing happening, and I just felt, I don't know, a lot of things started to change. I started spending more time there, and I bought a house there off the plan, and it certainly changed my attitude to a lot of stuff. I find that the atmosphere, the Thai people, the gentleness, the Buddhist thing and everything just totally relaxes me.
Do you have any of that? I didn't have it. The lime?
Yeah.
One day, about 3 years ago, I walked into a furniture art shop. I was looking for something for the house. And this girl, dressed in jeans and a check shirt, served me and couldn't speak much English.
So, yeah, can you ask who that?
And there was just a something happened, a connection thing, you know, which doesn't happen very often in your life. I think it's happened to me probably, that was probably the third time.
One man come back and to say hello, and sometime him try, him both give for me and him bring them back and hello, this for you. And oh, so lovely, thank you so much. Yeah, and today, tonight we're cooking, you have come dinner? And yeah, we go dinner.
Are you flying telephone?
Oh, wow.
Sometime.
Yes. Oh, that's a big one.
She just cares about me. I mean, she's just a wonderful person, and she certainly made me a better person. And everybody just loves her, and everybody just sees immediately what it's done for me.
Oh, it's been great. It's been great to see him in a new romance. He's a lot more relaxed, never yells, never screams. I could lose his house keys in Sydney. It's like, oh, no worries, we'll get another pair. 5 or 6 years ago, I would have been hiding under fear. So that's really good.
Million seagulls in the naked city.
Finally, true love blossomed, and they're a mad couple. He wanders around in his Hawaiian print shirt and his shorts, and she drives the little Corolla at 700 miles an hour, and they get on like a house. And it's fantastic.
On the beach.
Him not all for me, but him 60 and me 34.
It'd be nice to stay and watch the sun go down, but I'm hungry.
Buddha send a good man for me, and I don't care him worry old or worry young, but you send good man for me.
It's sort of warm.
We walk together every morning. I want to make him feel better. I look at him when he calm and relax and make him feel good. Yeah. And him told me when I see you, oh, I'm so happy.
You're from Thailand, huh?
Yeah.
This will probably sound crazy, but there's Chuggy and there's Chuggy. And I think the relationship that I have with Thailand have actually allowed the real Michael Chugg to come out rather than the Chuggy that is a rock and roll promoter and a character. And it actually allows me to be me and not have to be Chuggy. Because it sometimes, it, you know, it can really, it gets to you.
And I hope that you can say all your life achievements. We love you.
We had my 60th birthday there last year, and about 250 people came from around the world. Kids in this business, it was like if any of us made it to 30, we'd had a great life. But unfortunately, a lot of us are leaving the earth these days.
In the early hours of this morning, the music stopped. Thorpe died from a heart attack.
Dad and Thorpe, they were like brothers in some way. They were unbelievably close. When Billy passed away, he was just absolutely devastated. The way he was on TV, he's just not like that. Usually able to hold himself together.
I think it surprised everybody just how loved Billy Thorpe was. He was the real Aussie. Stand up and be counted and look after your mates.
Billy Thorpe was the seminal character that Michael followed through his musical career. So his public grief for Billy was not something that he invented. It's changed much of how Michael wants to now live the rest of his life.
Have a safe journey, mate. And don't be too hard on Elvis, Lennon and Hendrix when you tell them you've arrived to take over the band.
Michael doesn't want to ever live with regret anymore, that he hasn't gone and done the things that he should do, that he hasn't played out his life as a human being to the fullest extent.
I reckon America's there for the taking.
It's getting there. It's going to be hard work. But
in usual fashion, he's bounced back very strong. He's one of the founders of the Australian music industry, and he's a survivor. He's a loved guy. He doesn't have to prove anything to anyone anymore. There's no doubt, you know, if he was in trouble, I'd be there for him, and, you know, hopefully it'd be the same the other way around.
I'm not going to swear at all. I'm not going out there to abuse some media. I'm going out there to be nice. I might just swear now. You can all get...
This is Michael's life. He exists for this. And even though he'll deny it, he loves being more famous than his artists. After he got the Order of Australia, the first time I saw him after that, and I said something cheeky to him, and he said, "You address me as Lord Chugg from now on, if you don't mind." Okay, Lord Chugg, I do apologise.
Hey, Sydney!
The truth is, the act should be the most famous person up there. But, of course, half the time, Michael's the one who's, in this country, more famous than some of the bands he's introducing. But you're never going to get him off that stage, mate, in a million years. I've tried.
I got to tell you, you and us have taken Australian music to the world today.
I've had an amazing life. People say to me, when are you going to retire? Well, why would I retire? I do something I love and I'm going to keep doing it. The show rolls on and bring on the next tour and away we go again. And that's where it's at. Nothing's going to change.
I love that question. Does Chuggy like being famous? He loves being famous. And even though he'll deny it, he loves being more famous than his artists, quite honestly. Who said this about he's slowed down because of his heart attack? I haven't noticed. If Chuggy got into this business for the money, he's got a funny way of going about it.
Ever fantasized about moving to your favorite